Hello, everybody. Welcome back to PolyMatrix. I have been living with and working with the Samsung Galaxy Fit 3. I just realized my show notes here says the Fit 31. It's not the Fit 31. It's the Fit 3. This is actually a device I have come to learn much later through this, after I'd started this process, is not something that's actually officially supported nor sold within the United States. So if you get it, like I did, off of Amazon, it is usually imported from another country. It is not supported in the U.S. Samsung will not assist you. They also will not, their community forums will not assist you. So upfront, know that if you're in the U.S. and you get this, there is no U.S. support. There's no kind of support at all. You'll have to go digging around in the forums from whatever the originating country is. That said, I wanted to do a comparison to the Fit 3 compared to my Apple Watch Series 7, which seems like a very lopsided competition. I mean, the Apple Watch Series 7 is significantly more advanced than the Fit 3, but the Fit 3 offers a lot of the same features that the Series 7 has. So I thought, why not give it a shot and see if an entry-level device that's brand new compares to one of Apple's older devices that's a few generations old at this point, and how accurate they are compared to each other. I have no way of objectively comparing them. I don't have a polar heart rate sensor, nor do I have any actual proper medical grade equipment, but I just thought it would be an interesting day in the life of what using this for, I'm going to say 14 days, but there was an additional week, what I call my trial week. So this is the day I got the Fit 3 here, trial day one, and I calibrated it with the steps that I had that were listed as what I started with on my Series 7. And went from there and just kind of learned how it worked. And I'll leave all of these notes in the show notes. I'll leave a link for it so you can review it yourself and kind of get an idea of what I was doing as I went through this first week. But we're really going to look at things starting with kind of just general notes of the Galaxy Fit 3. And then we'll go into reviewing the day-to-day comparisons. So starting off, for the trial week or the calibration week, whichever you prefer, I really just was not confident that I got these two devices really set up in the same way. They don't measure exercise time the same, even though they both use that terminology. The Series 7 seems much more reluctant to anticipate what counts as exercise, and I also think that given the sync issues with the data to the Galaxy M34, that's the phone that I'm using to sync the Fit 3, the Samsung Health app is using data from both the Fit 3 and the M34, so that was what I learned fairly early on. I know it was using steps from both the M34 and the Fit 3, which is often why the step count was really high on the Samsung devices compared to the Apple devices. I turned off the physical activity permission in Samsung Health to see how this affects the daily reporting, and the two were more lined up a lot better. They're not perfectly the same, but they're a lot better. Apple seems to intelligently understand that if you have your Apple Watch on and are using it, that it's not going to count whatever steps the phone registers as you have it like in your pocket or whatever the case may be. When it comes to distances traveled, since I walk outside usually once a day, sometimes twice a day, the Fit 3 is dead on with the Apple Watch Series 7. When I'm using the Galaxy M34 to start the exercise, if I start the exercise from the Fit 3, even though it's supposed to use the GPS of the M34, the differences are pretty significant. And this is because the phone, not the Fit 3, is managing the GPS, the workout data, and the communication. So yeah, early on I figured out I have to do this from the Fit 3 or the comparison between the two devices is going to be pretty poor. When using the Fit 3 only and starting walking workouts, the distances are reported as being longer on the Fit 3 than the Series 7. I think this is because the Fit 3 isn't actually using the biometrics, such as the height and weight data, that is in Samsung Health, so it can only use whatever its built-in algorithm is for estimating distance traveled. That is to say, it's not very accurate for someone who is pretty close to average height in the USA, between 5'9 and 5'10. Granted, I am over my average weight for my age, and this could be affecting my stride. So it's possible I'm the problem, but I just don't think this is calibrated for we'll say a very common demographic within the US. The Series 7, in comparison, comes with GPS built in. And as a note, the Series 7 standalone or with my iPhone matches distances traveled when starting workouts from the Galaxy M34. As of the end of my calibration week, I don't know if it's more accurate at counting steps than the Fit 3. And while I didn't document the times here, the sleeping segments were pretty close between the two for the calibration week. Generally, the Fit 3 would usually have 20 to 30 minutes longer in sleep total per night, but the type of sleep recorded, such as awake, REM, light sleep, or deep sleep, roughly matched the Series 7. For calories burned, and this is an important note, I think this next segment is kind of long, but I think this is important. The Fit 3 seems much more reserved in its estimation. I am initially more willing to believe the Fit 3 over the Series 7 simply because a study done of fitness trackers in 2020, which I will link below, showed that the Apple Watch Series 6 was the closest to the correct amount of energy burned, but it's still overestimated by about 30%. I think this is relevant because the Series 6 and the Series 7 have the same sensors. The conclusion I'm drawing is that no device was very accurate in calories burned. However, I wonder if Samsung made changes over the years to be more conservative in its energy burn estimates. The channel called The Quantified Scientist has been doing ongoing testing, and it doesn't immediately appear that the newer Apple Watches change their metrics in any meaningful way. But Samsung's devices are all over the map, which is to say, a device like the Fit 3, we can't look at prior generation Samsung devices to help us determine if their measurementation they have is improving or worsening. And the last note I'll make about the heart rate, about this is the heart rate measurements. The Series 7 and the Fit 3 are pretty much dead even in every test I had done during my calibration week. Pilates, yoga, walks, run, yard work, random non-exercise measurements that are either exactly matched or off by just a few beats per minute. So, in my opinion, both of these devices can be used for reasonably accurate heart rate monitoring. As I stated earlier, I'll be linking all of the data that I collected over the course of these 2 weeks below and my trial week, but there was a couple days that stood out that I felt like needed some commentary. On the second day, this is my second usage day, not my trial or calibration day, but day two of proper testing, the Series 7 had me taking 35 steps before I'd even woke up that morning. The Fit 3 did not sync to Samsung Health the same as during my test week. It wasn't syncing the walking workout properly. I reset the Fit 3, did another short walk, and it still wouldn't sync any walking workouts, even though others synced just fine, such as Pilates and yoga and other. An interesting note that the Samsung Health app showed is that at some point my step count was updated overnight, so from going to sleep at day two and waking up on day three, even though the walking exercise wasn't showing up, the step count and exercise time had actually been updated. This is not ideal if you want in-the-moment syncing from Samsung Health, but at least you can still look at the Fit 3 later to review information for long-term tracking purposes. On day five, I made an interesting, I learned something interesting, kind of an interesting breakthrough here, is that the treadmill workout for the Fit 3 does sync with Samsung Health just fine. So I have a treadmill, and that's usually my indoor walking routine that I do, which is what I'm accustomed to seeing on the phone. So if I do the walking workout on the watch, I assume that it thinks you're doing an outdoor walk. So maybe there's some issues there that are, again, my fault, but it's also not made clear in the Samsung documentation as to what the walking workout entails. So starting at day five and moving forward, anytime I did a walking workout on the Fit 3, I would just do treadmill, at least if I was indoors. If I was outdoors, I would still set a walking workout for the outdoors. Day 6 was the first time I had noticed an interesting little output here where the Series 7 had a much higher calorie output than the Fit 3. I noted here that I think it was because a mind and body workout. It may have been started by my daughter when she was playing with my phone when I was holding her. She likes to grab my watch even if she can't see it on the other side of my arm and just press things. I didn't have the water lock on, so it probably registered starting a mind and body workout. Anyway, it said I burned 380 calories doing a mind and body workout, which is highly unlikely, but it threw off day six. So I'm not going to say that day six is particularly accurate. I'm going to note here that day seven was a rest day. It was kind of a busy day, but I didn't do a dedicated workout. But just a quick brief view of the numbers here. Reasonably close. Series seven, again, ahead by almost 300 calories. If we look at the day six where I said that things were off, it was by almost 350. So going on to day eight, this is where, again, I'm noting a change in calorie counting with the series seven. Up 349, so again, almost an additional 350 calories listed with the Series 7. Now, I didn't wear the Galaxy Fit 3 between Monday and Wednesday, so I took a two-day break after Day 7 and then started testing again on Day 8. So that was Sunday would have been Day 7, which means I started testing again on Thursday. At this point, I decided to switch wrists with the devices, so I put my Series 7 on my right wrist and my Fit 3 on my left wrist to see if it made any kind of difference with tracking or reporting, and the Fit 3 received an update Wednesday, at least Wednesday night, but the walking workouts still aren't syncing. This is the day that I discovered that that Samsung nor the Samsung community forums will support the Fit 3, and if you make a post about them, they will in fact take it down. And this is the first day during a workout that the Series 7 showed higher numbers than the Fit 3 in all categories during the workout, even if it's only barely in two of those categories. This is among categories both devices track, since the Series 7 doesn't show steps taken after the fact. So only if you're monitoring the step count before you start a workout and then noting the difference at the end of your workout, that is the only way to know how many steps you took during a workout with the Series 7 that I can figure out. Day 9 was a pretty bad day. I was feeling under the weather, so all of my numbers are kind of low. Again, the Series 7 is up by over 300 calories burned. Day 10 deserves a little bit of commentary here, because I feel like I slept a lot longer than 5 hours, but both of these devices said I only slept a little over 5 hours, but I woke up feeling great on this particular day. At the end of the day, again, Series 7 up by 350 calories. This is becoming pretty typical at this point. Workouts, very similar, very close together. Treadmill workout, so I started this Baby Steps to 5K. It's a program in Samsung Health, a routine to get you accustomed to doing a 5K marathon or a run. I don't know if that counts as a marathon, but a run. So this is what this workout is. And then I do a low intensity treadmill workout later in the evening. Again, things are very, very similar between the two. So day 14 here deserves a little commentary of its own. The Series 7 had me sleeping for an hour longer than the Fit 3 did. This is, I'm not sure how accurate this is, simply because the baby got up very, very early in the morning, and my wife attended to the baby. I was awake, but I was still in bed. I was thinking about the day, things I had to do, deadlines at work, that kind of deal. Wasn't playing on my phone. Just kind of relaxing and considering things. And what happened is that the watch, so the Series 7, thought that I was still asleep, apparently. So in this particular case, the Fit 3 is probably more accurate. So at the end of a 14-day comparative head-to-head, what do I think? Well, I won't be getting rid of my Apple Watch, I can tell you that. It's too reliable and too consistent, even if this project has shown me that sometimes the Apple Watch data is questionable. And despite that, the Fit 3 step counting is kind of all over the place. And sometimes it's less than 100 steps difference, but from my Series 7, but the delta could be different by thousands. And this is after my trial week, mind you. And that's on multiple days as well. After switching wrists, the Samsung daily steps are more believable, though not massively impacted by disabling the phone's physical activity permissions. So this is again when I disabled the Samsung Health app's access to that sensor on the phone. The daily step count is much closer to Apple's when I have my Apple Watch on my right wrist as opposed to my left wrist. Again, something very interesting. I like the Samsung Health app a lot more than I like Apple's Health app, to be honest. I think the data is presented in a much more pleasant and pleasing way. The sleep animal thing is kind of a little bit of a charm to it, but I don't really think it's for me. The feature feels more like something that might be an Asian-focused market would appreciate, and less so for Western customers. For sleep tracking, the Fit 3 is pretty close to the Series 7, close enough that I would say it's fair for general sleep time tracking, typically within 15 minutes or so of my Series 7. However, I would not use either device for sleep stage tracking, and I'm not an expert on this, so I can only parrot what little I've read and heard from others. There doesn't really seem to be a universally accepted near-perfect mechanism for sleep tracking. There's even debate about the gold standard scientific methods and models being used, and that those are only 80% accurate in the best of circumstances. Quantitative scientist does a lot with sleep stage tracking, and he uses the gold standard model, but others have said that particular methodology is not perfect, not ideally perfect. It's the best one that's out there by far, but it's not as perfect as we would like to believe it is. Just throwing it out there for whatever it's worth. All I'm saying is that these devices are not sleep stage tracking devices, and you should not use it for that purpose. If you want to track total hours and total time slept, I think that's probably fair. Heart rate tracking is pretty reliable. Pretty reliably the same between these two devices. I don't think you can go wrong with either one if that's what you're looking for. And I would also say, see my above note on day 8 about the calories, but given what I've learned from the Fit 3, I'm wondering if the tracking for this device is trying to assess kilocalories, which are kcal, instead of US calories that we use here. And this would explain the massive calorie difference between the two devices. At the end of the day, I think the Fit 3 is an interesting device. It's comparatively limited to the Apple Watch, but I don't think it's a bad device. Some major drawbacks are there's no microphone, so if you like having an assistant on your watch, I don't care. But if you like having an assistant on your watch, it's not going to do that. It's not going to have, it has no kind of built-in GPS. It's going to completely rely on the GPS that's on use on your phone. And the watch faces are very limited. There's no real complications or widgets or interactivity. It's just kind of a display device. Now, I mean, you can interact with the watch itself, but not the watch faces. Like, they don't have a quick access to weather, and that you can change that from weather to ECG or something to that effect. And one thing I've definitely enjoyed and that I will keep doing, and I take my Galaxy M34 with me when I do these, is this Baby Steps to 5K program. Over the more than a month now that I've had this device, and going on nearly a month of doing this Baby Steps to 5K program, I am, for the first time in many years, below 230 pounds. And I've been below 230 pounds now for a week, I think today, at the time of this recording, which is a Sunday. So this is, it's wonderful news for me. I feel motivated by it. I like it. I'm looking forward to the other programs that the Samsung Health app offers, particularly around walking and running. I'm not like a workout person. I don't enjoy working out. Some people get like a high and they love it. I'm not that guy. I actually hate it and despise it. But walking and doing a little bit of light running is fine, because it gets me, you know, it's the touch grass thing. You're outside, you got the sunlight on you, you get the vitamin D, all that good stuff. So I don't mind doing that, but I'm not somebody who's crazy about it. If you're kind of a filthy casual like me on this particular topic, I think the Fit 3 will do fine if you have a Samsung device. I have not tried using this with the Pixel, because you have to have a SIM card in order to install and run the Samsung Health app on the Pixel. This is the Pixel 6 I'm talking about. I don't know about any other model devices. I assume it's the same. If you don't have a Samsung device, then you have to have a SIM card in your phone in order to get it working. Again, iPhone users need not apply for the Samsung Health app. You're entering a whole different ecosystem, and never shall the twain meet, unfortunately. That being said, I hope you have found this video interesting, and I'm going to keep using this Fit 3. I like it well enough, and I don't think it's terrible, but most people, especially here in the US, are probably going to be better off getting the Galaxy Watch 4 or like one of the lower-end classic models that they offer on Samsung. As of this recording, I'm pretty sure that Samsung still offers the Galaxy Watch 4 on their website. So in saying that, I decided I would just go ahead and look it up. So yes, it is, the Galaxy Watch 4 is still sold at Amazon.com here in the US for $200. Switching over to eBay, you can find some used at very good prices. So this one's brand new. It's going for $145. It's a buy it now. Here's another brand new one. Bidding starts at $50. Or you can get best offer. Wow, these are actually really good deals. I mean, this one's like $50. Here we go, buy it now, $63. I paid $59 and some change for the Fit 3 on Amazon. So there's great deals out there if that's what you're looking for. I think the Watch 5 has a slightly better reputation and is slightly, you know, just some better sensors in it. I just think it's got a little bit of a better reputation online than the Watch 4. So you can get a decent Galaxy Watch for not a whole lot of money. At the end of the day, I hope this video has helped you provide a little context and just seeing how the difference is between a modern cheap device versus an older Apple expensive device might compare to each other. When I say cheap, I mean low cost. I do not mean poor quality. There are some poor quality issues about the Samsung side of things, but there's also things that I think Apple could definitely improve on. So it's not a, this is not meant to be taken as an Apple fanboy comment. I do think the Series 7 is better than the Fit 3, but now there's part of me that wants to try like a Galaxy Watch 5 and compare it to my Series 7 and see how they compare to each other. Anyway, never done something like this. I hope you've enjoyed it. Like and subscribe if you have not done so already, and I look forward to seeing you in the next episode. Take care now. Bye-bye.